Hello everybody, my name is Jinghui Yi, and in this video, I will present our recent work, Deep Learning for Non-Invasive Diagnosis of Nutrient Deficiencies in Sugar Beet using RGB images. In the process of plant growth, the plants require various mineral nutrients to grow and to complete their life cycle. Deficiency of these nutrients will result in different symptoms and will affect the growth, yield, and quality of plants and crops, as plants are already severely damaged when these symptoms are visible. It is important to diagnose nutrient status earlier to allow timely actions and to increase yield potential at minimal economic and environmental cost. However, current non-invasive methods deal in most cases with nitrogen deficiency only, and optical sensors such as chlorophyll meters do not monitor nitrogen, but instead measure changes in leaf spectral properties that may or may not be caused by nitrogen deficiency. Besides, destructive methods are time-consuming, expensive, and do not allow monitoring the nutrient status in real time. We therefore look for a cheaper and more practical method to diagnose nutrient deficiencies. We have investigated whether a deep learning-based method using RGB images might be helpful to overcome these limitations, because this method has the potential to extract distinctive features that are not visible to human eyes. Besides, properly designed deep learning-based methods can enable real-time and on-site detection of nutrient deficiencies, which are not possible or difficult with purely methods. For this purpose, we collected a dataset of high-quality RGB images with a smartphone camera for one growing season of sugar beet at the long-term fertilizer experiment Dikhobsov. And here are some examples from the dataset. The images were annotated with seven types of fertilizer treatments as listed below, namely unfertilized, nitrogen deficiency, phosphorus deficiency, potassium deficiency, omission of liming, optimally fertilized without manure, and with manure. Here, underline stands for the omission of corresponding nutrient treatment, while M plus S indicates application of supplementary mineral fertilizer and manure. Note that all images were taken under natural lighting and under different conditions in terms of height, viewpoints, and weather to increase the robustness of trend model. Here is the experimental setup of the long-term fertilizer experiment at Dikhobsov, where plus S stands for supplementary fertilization. The considered plots B7 to B13 are marked with a blue frame. All images were taken in these seven plots, each of which was subjected to one type of nutrient treatment. For example, an image with the label of underlined phosphorus, potassium, calcium indicates that it was taken in a plot that received no nitrogen, namely plot B8. As you can see, different from most of the related works, we focus on the whole plant instead of single leaf. For nutrient deficiency and disease detection in crops like tomato, the symptoms are easily observed in the leaves. However, these local patterns are usually recognized as nitrogen deficiency, as it is prevalent in many agricultural systems. Therefore, it is of interest to recognize and predict deficiencies based on the whole plants, which might offer global context instead of local patterns. And compared to typical classification problems, such as recognizing cats and dogs, classifying the nutrient status of crops is a challenging task even for human experts. For example, three sugar beets in the first row have similar viewpoint, brightness, and background, but different nutrient deficiencies. The visual appearance of these images are similar, indicating low interclass visual variation. In comparison, the images in the second row shows a high intraclass visual variation. It is worth noting that the images in the second row were taken at different dates, which also introduce enormous variation due to changing environmental conditions and crop development stages. Here is the basic statistics of our sugar beet dataset. There are 7 nutrient treatments and more than 5,000 images in total, and the images were taken at 10 different dates. Note that most annotations have a similar amount of images, but there is a small imbalance of the sample distribution among different dates. We used the proposed sugar beet dataset to systematically evaluate how accurate nutrient deficiency classification using RGB images can be. Here is a typical pipeline of image classification problem consisting of data preparation, training, and inference. During data preparation, we first randomly sample 70% of the images as a training set and the rest as a test set, and then apply several data augmentation strategies to increase the overall number of training samples, including cropping, rotation, and flipping. And during the process of training and inference, we analyzed and compared the performance of five CNN-based network architectures, including AlexNet, VGG, ResNet, DenseNet, and SquishNet. All of these models were pre-trained in ImageNet and fine-tuned in our dataset. It is worth noting that pre-training on ImageNet is currently a widely adopted strategy for CNN-based approaches on a variety of standard vision tasks, because it introduced general-purpose features that are shared across different tasks. However, we also noticed the enormous gap between our SugarBee dataset and ImageNet dataset. Therefore, we did not freeze any layers in these models to refine general features as well. Since deep learning requires a large amount of data, and currently large-scale agricultural datasets are still in great demand, we leave the pre-training on agricultural datasets to future works. Here are some results. The table shows that all trained models achieve an accuracy over 87% for classifying nutrient deficiencies in SugarBeet based on the whole plant. The network ResNet and DenseNet outperform the other methods by a large margin, mainly due to their gradient stabilizing shortcut connections. The best performance is achieved by DenseNet with an accuracy of 98.4%. SquishNet has the fewest parameters, hence it is more suitable for resource-limited platforms. But it comes at the cost of a much lower accuracy compared to DenseNet. Besides, as we can see from the table, pre-training is essential and the pre-trained model outperform their counterparts trained from scratch in terms of accuracy and training time. Although researcher has reported that pre-training can only help to speed up convergence, but not to improve performance when the target dataset has, for example, more than 10,000 images. Pre-training is still important for classifying nutrient deficiencies, because data acquisition in the field is very difficult, and training data will always be a limiting factor. We further highlight the saliency regions in the original image that have a high impact on the final predictions. It's obvious that ResNet and DenseNet output their predictions with visual attention on large patches containing all the leaves, where symptoms caused by nutrient deficiencies were obviously observed. However, the other three models only focus on local areas. We also noticed that all models take the soil into account, which is a limitation of all networks, and it is an important research direction to ensure that the networks focus only on plants. Now, considering the case of DenseNet in random split, where 98.4% classification accuracy has been achieved, this figure shows the separation of the classes based on the learned features in two-dimensional space. For some classes, we have distinct clusters. The samples of the category nitrogen underlying potassium calcium overlap slightly with the samples of the category with all fertilizers, so that they are more likely to be classified as each other, which is also visible in the confusion matrix in the upper right corner. This is expected since phosphorus deficiency is the by far most difficult deficiency to be recognized in SugarBeet. To sum up, all models are able to recognize the symptoms of nutrient deficiencies in SugarBeet with a high accuracy when it is trained and tested in random splits. That is, all growth stages of plants have been observed. However, when we train and test our model with images from different growth stages, the classification accuracy varies between 48.5% to 84.4%, depending on the data that has been used for testing. This is a much more challenging and interesting task since the plants will grow over time. For future work, domain adaptation should be adopted when training set and test set are sampled from different distribution and when labels are not available in test set. Besides, although great CAM can highlight the saliency regions in the original image that have a high impact on the final predictions, it is still hard to find intuitive interpretations to help us understand the behavior of networks. Therefore, more visualization techniques can be developed for better understanding the correlations among input features and nutrient deficiencies. And finally, although the SugarBit dataset is already a very useful benchmark, there is still a need for more related datasets, such that data from different years, locations, crop species, and crop cultivars can be used to evaluate the robustness of methods for recognizing nutrient deficiencies. And thank you very much for watching this video.